they tolerated and they allowed that mark to move. They said, well, we would never typically allow this, but we'll make an exception here. And so now your baseline for what you're willing to accept in your world is now shifted. And then that happens again and again and again. Pretty soon you end up with a World War II, or you end up with an October 7th. So that is happening. The spiritual outcome of this, we'll get through this, and there'll be a time we look back. You and I will do one of these conversations, and this will be in our rearview mirror. And the question is, what kind of people, what kind of a society have we allowed ourselves to become? Will we be casualties of hate and fear?
I'd like to welcome back to the show, returning champion again, Gregg Braden. How are you doing, Gregg?
Alex, I am doing really, really well. It's so good to see you. I'm excited about this program today. You know, we are completely unscripted. We never know where it's going to go. And there is a world of information out there that is waiting for us to open the door to deeper understandings, deeper meanings. And I just want to tell you how much I appreciate the opportunity to be with you and your community. Your community is my family. So yes. I am coming to you today from our studio just outside of Santa Fe, New Mexico. And it is a beautiful late year, sunny, cold day. It's a perfect day to have this conversation.
Well, my friend, the reason I wanted to bring you back on so soon after we've had two amazing conversations recently, but because of the events that happened on October 7th overseas in Israel and what's been going on with the Ukraine now for months and months and months, I keep getting asked by my community about how to deal with this on a spiritual standpoint, how to deal with the pain and the suffering that people are going through, how to deal with just the energy of what's happening in the world right now, because it doesn't seem like there's a lot of guidance coming from, let alone governments, but coming from spiritual leaders from other places. Nobody wants to kind of talk about this. And I wanted to kind of get into the weeds a little bit, not as much of the details about the conflicts, but more on these grander ideas of what is happening to humanity, why we're going through this, how we deal with this suffering, and so on. So I will drop that ball into your court, sir, and see where we go.
Well, before we begin, I will need your permission and the permission of your audience. Are you okay if we push back against mainstream narratives and if we are deep, honest, truthful, and factual about everything that we're going to talk about?
Absolutely.
Yeah. And people say that at the beginning. And then when we get into the weeds, I have to remind them that they said that.
Fair enough.
Yeah. This is a big conversation. So you mentioned October 7th. I'll begin just by saying I was in a hotel room in London the morning of October 7th, an hour before I was to go on stage and present to a live audience at a conference. And I don't own a TV here in the United States. I don't watch news. The hotel news feeds at breakfast and in the hallways and the restaurants and everything, they were carrying the news feeds of what was happening. And what was interesting, Alex, is because those news feeds were coming out of the Middle East, they were coming out of Asia and parts of Europe. Because of the time difference, it was too early for American media to be reporting on the Hamas attack in Israel on October 7th. So I went onto the stage that day and presented to an audience knowing what was happening, just the beginnings of knowing what was happening, and also knowing that my audience had no idea what was going on. And then as I went back later in the day to catch up on all that information, something became abundantly clear to me, and that was that the people of the United States of America were not being allowed to see the images and to understand the depth of what had happened on October 7th in the way that other people in other parts of the world and other media were being allowed to share that information. Now, I say this because it's important. We live our lives based upon the way we choose to think about ourselves, our relationship to the world. We form our opinions, we form our narrative, we choose our policies, we pass our laws, all based on the way that we think about ourselves and the events of the world. And it became abundantly obvious that in the U.S., on a couple of different levels, that narrative was being directed in a very specific way. And based on that direction, many people, and especially young people in America, were making choices and throwing support behind terror and organizations that they were not given the privilege to understand truly the depth of what it was that was happening. So this is a specific example, Alex, and I'm going to use this to tie into the question that you asked. We are all casualties of an insidious kind of warfare that most people do not even understand is happening. We're at war right now, and there are multiple levels. There's an ancient battle between good and evil. We all know that, and it plays out in different ways. There's a battle for our bodies. We've just witnessed that over the last few years and the sovereignty of our bodies. There's a battle for our thoughts. There's a battle for our beliefs playing out in classrooms, textbooks. It's playing out across mainstream media. And that battle informs us of what we believe to be true about the events of the world. And it's based on those beliefs then that we act. So a couple of things. First of all, the news feeds were not showing the horrific images, and they are not easy to see, of what happened on October 7th. By choice of those news organizations. And then there are the algorithms of the social media that have made it almost impossible for the truth of those kinds of events to come through based on what are called community rules and community guidelines. So the net effect is we have demonstrations on college campuses here in the United States, all over our news right now, we're all seeing it, of young people passionately demonstrating in support of an ideology that they only have a fraction of an understanding about. They are passionate. I think they're good people. They want to do the right thing. And it's based on information that is incomplete at best. Some of it is disinformation, some of it's misinformation. And this happens all the time. It's happening with climate change. It's happening with the war in Ukraine. It's happening with presidential campaigns. So this is nothing new. But the reason I think this is important and where this ties into the Next Level Soul podcast is because there's an opportunity in front of us right now, Alex. Now I'll lay it out and then we can unpack this a little bit. When we know the truth, the horrendous truth of the horrendous atrocities that we can't even mention on this program right now, but people, if they want to know what it is that's happening, it's out there, it's on the dark web, it's on alternative news sources. When we see what humans did to humans, it is nothing less than pure absolute evil. If I could find a different word, I would. These weren't crimes against people. It wasn't about killing people. The death of those people was the last consequence after they had extracted as much suffering, emotional, physical, and psychological suffering as they could. Then the death is what happened afterward. And what I have seen, and I haven't even seen what a lot of the news media was allowed to see, it makes what happened in World War II and some of those death camps pale by comparison. And I know that's hard to believe in the 21st century. This is pure evil. And what is happening now through fifth generational warfare is those events are being conflated with a political conversation about the people in that part of the world, about the Israelis, about the Palestinians. They're being tied together in a way to promote a thinking and ideology. So I'm just going to begin by saying the events of October 7th, we have to see as separate from that political conversation. And we've got to condemn that evil. There has to be a place in this world in this fundamental battle between good and evil, where we draw a line and say, this cannot stand. We cannot do these things. We will not accept these things in our society. And what is so interesting is that through this fifth generational warfare, we've all been led down a path where we make exceptions, Alex, and we accept things into our lives that we would never normally accept on a daily basis. And we accept, we say, well, we're good people, and we'll extend, you know, an olive branch of acceptance and tolerance. And what happens is we move off of the mark of what is good and true and what we accept in our lives just a little bit. But that becomes the new normalized baseline for what is tolerated in our world. And then from that, something happens again, and we do it again and again and again. And pretty soon, we're so far, we have normalized things in our society that when we turn and look back, we say, what in the world were we thinking? So when it comes to the events of October 7th themselves, I think what we have to do is each of us is faced with a choice in our own hearts and our own minds in terms of where we are with the atrocities that were perpetrated and what needs to be done. Now, this is where the spiritual element, this is one of those beautiful places where spirituality comes front and center in our daily lives, because those events have triggered a global momentum now. And what is happening in response to October 7th on between nations, on political levels, in the United Nations, in people's living rooms, in our society, on our college campuses, at our nation's capitals, the protests, the riots, everything that is coming from this. We're going to get through this. We'll get through this. Here's the spiritual component, Alex, the deeply spiritual component. What we have to say is, what do we become in the presence of what the world has brought to our doorstep? What do we allow, pure unadulterated evil playing out in the way that it did? What do we allow that evil to do to us, and how do we respond to that evil? This is where the controversy and a lot of the very difficult conversations come in. And I am surprised at the lack of response from our spiritual leaders, our, you know, our gurus, people that we've grown up listening to, because it's easy to be spiritual when everything's good. It's easy to be spiritual and to work with the law of attraction and all the principles and in the book, The Secret, and all of that when everything is good. When life becomes difficult, how well those principles serve us in helping us to navigate what is now front and center in a healthy way. How do we get through this in a healthy way? And as I look, and a lot of these people are my friends and my colleagues, and I've talked to some of them, and there are three things happening. Alex, number one, some of them are afraid to speak out. They are just afraid because they don't want to be canceled based on their opinions. They're afraid of how their community is going to respond, number one. Number two, sadly, some of my friends have spiritual practices that they're discovering have failed them. And for lack of a better term, I have to say it's because the practices are shallow in the sense that they are fair weather practices. They're still good people, and they've done what they believed was true, and now their belief systems are being tested, and their spiritual principles are not serving them. Yeah. And number three, I've spoken to dear friends and colleagues who say they just don't want to. They don't want to take a side. They want to sit on the fence, and they don't want to communicate anything. And some of them say it's so intense they're just going to go down to the beach and do some yoga. They can't handle it. They can't handle it. None of those are right, wrong, good, or bad. And this isn't about making people wrong. It's about truthful, honest, and factual, a factual evaluation of where we are. If our belief systems cannot serve us in difficult times, then what good are they? That's my feeling. So here's where I am on this. The evil that was perpetrated cannot stand. And I think we're beyond the point of simply talking down that evil. There has to be action. And we're seeing action, very controversial action. The question is, and this is, some people say that this is splitting hairs. But what I'm going to share with you and our community, I think, is the crux. It's not splitting hairs. It's the crux of what's up for us. What do we allow the horror of those events to do to us? What do we become? Do we do what is necessary to address that evil from the place of the love in our hearts for what we know is possible? Or have we succumbed to the most primal instincts of hate and revenge and anger and fear? And is that what is driving the action? So the reason people say it's splitting hairs, they say, okay, Gregg, if there's a war and people die, what difference does it make? Yes, on the third dimensional level, people will die needlessly, and the suffering needlessly. And I think civilians should always be, in my opinion, civilians should always be taken out of the equation before the military goes at it. There's a whole conversation around that. So people will die. Here's the point. What do we become as we address that evil? And I know people on both sides. I know people that are so full of, they have succumbed to the fifth generational warfare. And now they have those primal instincts that we all have of the rage, and the anger is changing them. They have become something that they were not before this event happened. And this is what we have to ask ourselves. When we respond to the information, have we become something? Have we betrayed our truest nature? Have we become something that we would never choose to become in a million years? Or can we maintain our connection to the love and the good in this world and recognize that there's no place for evil and address that without sinking to the level that evil wants us to sink to? So I'm going to stop there for a minute and unpack that. I want to ask Alex, does that make sense if I say it in that way?
It does make sense. It makes absolute sense, because as you were talking, you know, the first images that came into my head are, well, the question that always gets asked, like, how could someone like Hitler rally an entire country to do these atrocities, or Mussolini with Italy, or in Japan, or even Castro in Cuba, where I'm from, how can you rally an entire country to do things that it goes so against their nature, only to be like, I think it's at the end of World War II, the German people looked around like, oh my God, what have we become?
Yeah.
They stopped and said, and then Italy was the same thing. I mean, and they took it out on Hitler and Mussolini, to say the least. But, but you start looking and you start going, what have I become because of this anger and because of the information that was given to me? And if my history serves me correct, and please correct me if I'm wrong, you know, someone like Hitler came to power because there was, people were losing money. Their money was being, is worthless. And then they needed to create a new villain. And they said, oh, it's the Jews. And everyone's like, sure, that's who it is. And that's the way all wars are. You dehumanize the other side to the point where it's not even, it's okay. It doesn't really matter because they're not really human. That dehumanization is so dangerous. When, you know, when I see some of the videos of both sides, of both in the Ukraine and in Israel right now, you know, at the end of the day, everybody just wants to live a happy, secure life, follow their dreams, love their loved ones the same way you and I do. So it's, I love what you're saying, is like, what will we become through this? And I think that's something so important that people listening should understand.
Well, this is where now this is Next Level Soul Podcast. This is where we are, so we can have this conversation. This is where the deeper spiritual principles come out. We are all being tested, and mm-hmm. It's not happening in a vacuum. We're being tested on the battlefield, the battle between good and evil that has been raging since we first set foot on this earth. What's different now is there are new tools to facilitate that battle. Technology, social media, algorithms, AI. These are tools that have never been present before. And so they are elevating this battle. Again, fifth generational warfare. Let me just say a couple words about this. In a conventional war, you mentioned World War II, typically what would happen is that the enemy, the term was used, was called being softened up. So the enemy would be softened up with planes dropping bombs, missiles, everything from a distance to minimize casualties from the invading army. And then the invading army would come in. That principle applies right now. There is a battle for our thoughts. There's a battle for our planet. Geoengineering, and I know you've had guests on talk about that. There's a battle between good and evil, and we're talking about that now. In fifth generational warfare, we are softened up through the battle in our mind, the battle in our heart. It's a psychological warfare before the kinetic war ever begins. The kinetic war is when it comes to elections. The kinetic war may be boots on the ground with troops. And there is a concerted, I'm hesitating because I don't know how deep we want to go into that rabbit hole, but there is a concerted effort to remake the world. And I think we all know that through the policies and principles that are being enacted. Many of them, the goal is to enact them before the year 2030, within the next 7 years, which would require a level of social engineering and a magnitude of social change that we've never seen in our lives before. There's an urgency to change our world. Fifth generational warfare is playing a powerful role in that. I do a whole video about this on my YouTube channel if people want to go into to depth and see the different domains of the warfare. But the point is, now the battle between good and evil that is playing out. These events have happened. There was a time where I think they could have been nipped in the bud, Alex, honestly. I think there's a time if we had honored the signs, honored one another through our hearts and communication, listening to the needs and the goals and the desires and the dreams of everyone involved, I think we could have avoided what happened on October 7th. The same is true with World War II. It didn't happen overnight. There were events leading up to it. It could have been nipped in the bud many, many times.
Right.
People turned their heads. They looked away. They tolerated and they allowed that mark to move. They said, well, we would never typically allow this, but we'll make an exception here. And so now your baseline for what you're willing to accept in your world has now shifted. And then that happens again and again and again. Pretty soon you end up with a World War II or you end up with an October 7th. So that is happening. The spiritual outcome of this, we'll get through this and there'll be a time we look back. You and I will do one of these conversations and this will be in our rearview mirror. And the question is, what kind of people, what kind of a society have we allowed ourselves to become? Will we be casualties of hate and fear? And will we lower ourselves and allow ourselves to think in our everyday lives the way that people are thinking in response to what happened to October 7th? And this is a very, very powerful, very fundamental difference. There's a huge difference if you are at war. There's a huge difference between going to war and maybe taking lives, that happens in war, from the love of what you know is good and true and beautiful and the light of the world that you know is possible. There's a huge difference between that and going to war from the hate that has been ignited within you, the fear of what happens if you don't do these things, and lowering and succumbing to those primal, dark human potentials and allowing that to become part of your life, part of your society as well. We're all being tested, every one of us, how we respond to what's happening. And this is where it gets insidious, because we can only respond based upon what we believe to be true, what we know. And all of us are casualties of fifth generational warfare, because we're all subject to the images that and the narratives that we're being allowed to see, unless we take it upon ourselves to really do the work, to dig deep, to look at alternative media, and to seek out more information than you would get from your favorite cable news network channel.
I think with everything you're saying, our friend Bruce Lipton, who has talked about programming early on, everything that you're saying, we can only deal with the world based on the programming and the lens that has been put upon in front of us. That could be by our parents, that could be by our community, and then that's the early programming. But then that programming continues into adulthood through media, social media, movies, television, all sorts of whatever we consume, books, whatever kind of media you consume, will continue to do that programming. So it's very difficult for people who have a worldview that this group of people, because my parents said that this group of people did this, this, and this to us. And these movies I saw said the same thing. And also these books I saw the same thing. There'll always be something to reinforce what you already believe. But what is more important is to seek out information against your viewpoint, against your programming, to see the other side. And I always look at, anytime these situations present themselves to me, I always look, as no matter how much you might hate somebody or hurt somebody, or you know, or what type of group, at the end of the day, they are human beings who want the same things you want. They want love. They want shelter. They want a secure way to follow their, you know, their you know, roof, shelter, food, clean food, a way to follow their dreams. We all, every single one of us on this planet, no matter where we live, want those things. So with this new technology that you've been talking about, with specifically social media, that algorithm has no emotion. It just does what it's programmed to do. So if I watch a Gregg Braden video, and I watch two or three more of them, I'm going to be served up probably more Gregg Braden videos if I can keep watching that. And you can go down the Gregg Braden rabbit hole. Same thing. You watch one Next Level Soul episode, I'm probably going to give you another one and another one. So it can be used for quote unquote good things, positive things in the world, because that algorithm is what's helped the show grow as large as it has.
Sure.
But if you go down the wrong rabbit hole and you kept getting fed and you're not realizing that you're being fed, reinforcing the same narrative again and again, your view of the world is so small, and it's like a small echo chamber that you don't even, that happens in politics, it happens with health and nutrition, it happens with the world, the climate, it happens with everything. You have to open your mind to other possibilities and not only see what's right in front of you, but search out other points of views. Would you agree, sir?
I would agree 1,000,000%. And that's why I am so deeply appreciative of you and Next Level Soul podcasts and programs like this. You know, a lot of people in the United States don't realize this. Our media is regulated. There are six large corporations that own over 90% of the media. And that includes newspapers, magazines, radio, talk shows, as well as television. So, and what's interesting is some of those corporations will own two newscasts that look like they're opposing. One of them will be liberal, one will be conservative, but they're owned by the same corporation. Those corporations have narratives that benefit them financially, economically, politically. A lot of them are very politically motivated. Yes, and so those narratives will be directed down to the news personalities that we know and we love and we trust. We've invited these people into our living rooms. If you have a television, you know, for years, we've trusted them through the good times and the bad times. They are fed a narrative. And what's interesting, and maybe you've ever done a little experiment with this, when there's breaking news, go to any of the cable television networks and see how they're reporting it. What is their lens? What words are they using? What language? Now you go to another channel and they're using exactly the same phrases, exactly the same words. You go to a channel now that you think is on the other side of the spectrum, and they're using the same language and the same words, because it's all coming down. It's being driven through economic and political lenses from those six primary corporations. There are independent news outlets that are out there, and they're growing. There are more of them now than there were, but you have to really put some energy into it. Alex, you've got to want to find other perspectives, and you have to seek them out. And I have yet to find any mainstream cable news network that is 100% accurate, because it's all based on a style of news now that is called commentary. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you remember when I was a kid, you know, back in the 50s and 60s, you know, Walter Cronkite would do his very best to remain objective. The big deal when he broke down and cried when Kennedy was pronounced dead, he took his glasses off. He put his hand over his eyes and he cried on network TV. That was unheard of. That was something that never happened, because he breached his objectivity is what happened. But he also showed his humanness. And it was a very difficult time in the world and in the United States. Today, all of our news, we get the pictures, but the media feels like we need someone to tell us what to think about those pictures. And that's a very, very different kind of journalism. Mm-hmm. So that journalism is directed through the lens of those narratives of those six corporations, who have interests, sometimes not necessarily in our interest, in our best interest. So this is what makes this conversation difficult, because people are, I think, generally are good people. They're passionate. You see the students on Ivy League campuses supporting the terror organization that committed the most horrible atrocities. And then you watch the interviews where the students are being asked about the atrocities, Alex, and what they're saying is those atrocities never happened. Or if they did happen, why haven't we seen it? They say they're saying it's a narrative, it's a trumped up narrative that they never happened because we've never seen the pictures. Well, they've never seen the pictures based on the first couple of minutes of what we talked about in this podcast. Number one, American media is not allowed to show it. Number two, even if it was, the social media algorithms will bar those images because they are so absolutely horrific. They're worse mm-hmm. than a Hollywood movie, you know, of death and destruction, because the people aren't dead, they're alive. The atrocities are being exacted upon people while they are living. And death is the ultimate outcome. It's not to kill those people. It's to cause as much suffering as possible. And we're not wired to see that. Our society is not wired. Our bodies, it's difficult for our bodies to see those things, Alex. And I'm not saying that we all should, because once you see them, you cannot unsee them.
Right.
And if you are in an emotional or a psychological place where you cannot compartmentalize and find meaning in that, it's probably better not to see. So I'm not saying that these should be blared across network news. What I am saying is that our country is being shredded, and our society and even our families at the family dinner table, where the young people see one news feed, adults see another news feed, and they have a difference of opinion because they both believe what they saw is the truth.
Right.
This is fifth generational warfare. It's psychological warfare, and it's very effective. So that's happening on that level. For me, I'm looking beyond that. At the very, very deep level, We are living a time unlike any time in the history of our civilization, of any recorded civilization. We're living the convergence of many cycles that our society doesn't think in terms of cycles. We're living a convergence of climate cycles, of economic cycles, conflict cycles. I shared with the UN, Bruce Lipton and I were at the UN a few years ago, and I shared with them about conflict cycles. And they said, you know, what do you mean? Isn't conflict spontaneous? Doesn't it just happen when it happens? It may. But if you look at the wars, when they begin, when they end, they are at the top and the bottom of sine waves that link directly to cosmic influences like solar cycles, like the magnetic cycles of the Earth. And we are in one of the cycles right now where we are vulnerable to conflict. Doesn't mean we must have conflict. It means we are more susceptible, but it's also an opportunity, if you know that, to become really good listeners, to listen to other ideas, to be open to new ways of thinking. And the beautiful thing, it's at the top and the bottoms of these sine waves where not only do we find the beginning of conflict, but we find the greatest opportunities for peace. We are literally living the greatest opportunity for peace right now because of where these cycles are. But that is dependent upon us recognizing the cycles and recognizing the opportunity. Otherwise, we give in, and we're seeing this play out. We give in to these primal urges to solve our problems through conflict. And all of that is happening now. Those cycles are converging. And as spiritual beings, all of our belief systems are being tested, and we get to see what works and what doesn't. The ones that don't work, let's don't do them anymore. And the ones that work well, let's get together and we'll do a lot of those. And the heart is key to all of this. So what you were saying just a few moments ago, it's so right on. But this is where the heart is so powerful, Alex. And we talked about this in a previous podcast. The brain is a polarity organ. Left brain, right brain, we all know that. Because it's a polarity organ, if we interpret the events of the world through our brain, through our left and right brain, the brain will do what it always does. It will see that in polarity. It'll see the good and the bad and the right and the wrong, the success, the failure, the worthy, the not worthy. We do that in our relationships. We do it with the health of our bodies. You know, we do it with our friends, and we do it with global events. The heart is not a polarity organ. And the neural network that was discovered in the heart in 1991, reported in 1994 that we talked about in previous podcasts. This is, it's so interesting to me. This is one of those places where science and spirituality come together in this really beautiful way. Because our ancestors always told us the heart was the key. And now we know that when we interpret the events of life through the neural network in our heart rather than our brain, our heart does not see the polarity, the right, wrong, good, bad, worthy, not worthy. It sees the events objectively for what they are. And from that objective place, we can make healthy choices about the best way to move forward rather than fall into the ego loops. This is what the ego is all about, the left and the right brain. Rather than falling into those ego loops, they just make us all crazy. You know, the heart, it doesn't change what happens. It gives us, it empowers us to objectively consider what has happened in the world and to move forward in the best possible way, in the healthiest way.
Do you think that that's why we are going through all of this right now? Do we have to, I mean, as a species, as a collective consciousness, do we have to go through all of this war and pain and suffering at this moment in life for us to make that choice? Are we basically, is it really being shoved in our face?
You know, this is one of the most interesting things to me. I know a lot of our viewers know that I was I'm a scientist. First of all, I'm a degree scientist. Background in earth science, my degree in earth science, my background in as a senior computer system scientist during the Cold War years, really looking behind the scenes at what was happening during the Cold War? What was the foundation? It was a very frightening time in the history of our world. And I began to study history in general, beyond the Cold War. And what I found, Alex, and I don't understand this fully, I'm just recognizing it, is that we humans appear to experience what we don't want before we know we don't want it, rather than stating what we do want and putting our heart and our mind and our time and our energy to achieving those things. It's kind of like we're collective mice in a maze, and we go down this path and we say, oh, World War I. Well, we don't want World War. So we go back and we try something else. Whoop, World War II. Well, we don't want World War. You know, we had to have two World Wars, had to have multiple Holocausts. And we say, well, we don't want those. But have we learned? Because here we are teetering on the brink of World War III, and we're seeing a Holocaust that unfolded on October 7th, exactly what that is. So do we have to do that? My sense is we don't, but most people don't know that we have a choice. And this is what the core of our most ancient and cherished spiritual traditions and the religions of the world are all about: our relationship to this choice. We could choose a world of peace and harmony. It appears that we will have to come close to losing that world. And I think we'll come very close, but I don't think that we will. I think we will prevail. And I have very, very solid scientific reasons, as well as spiritually based reasons, as well as cyclic and timeline based reasons that we haven't talked about. I think that truth, light, honesty will prevail. And I think we will experience a lot of suffering to get to that place. I don't think we have to. It seems to be the way we learn. What's so interesting to me, there was a time, we just stated this, that we could have avoided what happened on October 7th. There was a time that could have been avoided through dialogue, heartfelt human-to-human dialogue. It didn't, and now we're in it. And the only way out of it is to go through it. We have to go through at least this iteration, because it's already started. We're already in it. And I think this is what's up for all of us. It's up for the nations of the world, for the leaders of the world. What kind of nations do we become? What kind of leaders do we become? What kind of individuals do we become? Do we do what needs to be done? We've got to face this evil head on and say, there is no place for this level of evil, this evil in our world, in our lives. We will not stand for this. Can we do that from the love of claiming the good in the world rather than the hate and the fear of what happens if we don't? Powerful, powerful difference. A lot of people, I said that on one of my own YouTube channels, and people pushed back and they said I was splitting hairs. Again, I mentioned that. They said, what difference does it make? On a soul level, it makes all the difference in the world. When we leave this world at the end of this cycle and we're no longer in these bodies, if we are to believe what the best science of the modern world suggests, what the spirituality of our ancestors suggests, and what our deepest spiritual beliefs have led us to accept, it's what we have honed our spirituality to become that travels with us. That is the fruit that we reap at the end of this life cycle. So how we get to that fruit makes all the difference in the world. And I believe that we can, we all have warriors inside. There are times we have to fight. Mm-hmm. We had to fight in World War II. If we didn't, we'd be living in a very different world today. We're in it now. We've got to fight. But we've got to fight from a place where the war does not betray our truest nature, doesn't make us into something that we're not. And that's a big concept, Alex. I know it is. And a lot of people are really grappling with what that means in their lives.
Do you think that the reason why you said earlier that the reason it seems as a species that we need to feel the fire before we understand that burns us,
yeah,
in order to make it happen, is that a primal programming of negative bias? because we listen and hear more of if the tiger's down by the river is going to kill us than unicorns. And you, out of all the noise in the world, you go for the negative first because it's a survival instinct. Do you think that's one of the reasons why we need to figure out first the pain before we go, we don't want that?
Well, it's a big question. And I think it goes right back to day one of the day we emerged on this planet. We live in a polarity world. And in that polarity, all things are possible. The question is, what do we identify with the most? From a quantum perspective, all possibilities exist in the quantum soup as potential. When we collapse those potentials and bring them into a reality of our everyday lives, we go from a scalar potential to a vector reality, is how a scientist would say this. Mm-hmm. It's based on what we have become, what we are giving that field to work with. If the field is always mirroring what it is that we claim to be true in our hearts, then what it says, and this is one of the most powerful spiritual principles, Alex, we must become in our lives what we choose to experience in the world. We must become in here what it is that we want that quantum field to show us out there. So if we want love and we want to be loved by other people, how is that possible if we've not found that love for ourselves? This is an example. Because when we are feeling that love for ourselves, that's what we're feeding the field, and the field can now mirror that back to us. It is an analogy would be as if that quantum field is the internet and what's in our heart is the algorithm. So what is the algorithm that we're developing? Are we developing an algorithm of love and self-respect and self-worth? And if we are, then that algorithm is going to bring in the opportunities to reinforce that time and time again. We live in a society where we've been taught we are powerless victims, that we are bad people, that we are a bad nation, that we are, this is being taught in universities, that we are powerless victims when it comes to illness and when it comes to disease, and that we mm-hmm. need something outside of us because we don't have what we need and we're not worthy of those things. If we believe that, and that's the programming that you were just mentioning a few moments ago, if that's the program from the womb up to the first 7 years of birth, then we shouldn't be surprised that the field simply is feeding us back. The field's neutral. It's just going to give us what we give it to work with. Mm-hmm. If we're feeding the field programs of we're not worthy, we're powerless victims, then the field's going to give us all kinds of opportunities to validate those beliefs. If, on the other hand, we can truly love ourselves, and the way that love is expressed is by honoring the gift of life, the gift of our bodies. Everything, I mean, simple. Every moment of every day, Alex, we make choices that either affirm or deny life in our bodies on a very fundamental level. What do we choose to nourish our bodies when we take the time for a meal? Something as simple as that. Is the nourishment that we place into our bodies, is it as close to its natural form and is it the highest form of nutrition, or is it a bunch of chemicals in a matrix that have been mushed together in a machine that have never seen the light of day? Those are two very, very real possibilities that we have every day of our lives. Mm-hmm. When and we all have to make exceptions. If you're on an airplane at 39,000 feet for 14 hours and all you got's a candy bar, then that candy bar, I'm grateful for the candy bar, you know?
I mean, that little brisket cookie that they give you, it's really, I looked at once the chemicals on, I was like, oh yeah, let's not do that again. But it tastes good up there.
it does. And so I am not so structured. I make a promise to myself. Well, so let's do this from a spiritual perspective. Most of your viewers, you have a very sophisticated audience, a very well-educated audience. And that's why I love sharing with you and this audience, because we can have these conversations. I think most people in the audience are familiar with the ancient Essenes, E-S-S-E-N-E-S, mm-hmm. The mysterious sect that showed up 500 years before the birth of Jesus. Jesus' mother was an Essene. Jesus was an Essene. The Dead Sea Scrolls were written, or at least transcribed by Essenes. And in the Essene Gospels, there are Gospels that were edited out of the Christian Bible based on Essene traditions. They're in the Vatican libraries, and they're available for, you could do a search on the internet, you can find them. There is a conversation, a dialogue, that the Master, Jesus, not as a religious figure, but as a learned man, he is with a group of people, and they're saying, what should we use to nourish our bodies? Now, you could go through a list of all the good things and all the bad things, you know, and red meat and tofu, and, you know, you could do all that. His principle is so powerful. I learned this early in my life, and I've applied it every day in my life since. He simply said this. He said, the forces that steal the life from your food steal also the life from your body. And the forces that give life to your food give life also to your body. Therefore, choose the forces that give life to your body. And that is a 2,000-year-old principle. Couldn't be more right on. What he's saying, the stuff that you do to the food that destroys that food, the way it's cooked, the way it's prepared, the chemicals, the additives, the heat that destroys that food, it's going to destroy your body. Right on. I mean, you can't get any clearer than that. But the things that allow your food to be alive, to keep those nutrients intact, that's what's going to keep your body intact. And it's an ancient but not an obsolete principle. And this is just one place, one little example in our everyday lives where we either choose to affirm or deny life in our bodies. We choose to affirm or deny life through the language that we use. The acoustic patterns that we create with our diaphragm and our vocal cords that reflect our thoughts and our emotions of our innermost beliefs, those acoustic patterns have a direct impact upon us and the people around us. Words are powerful. Words have meaning. How do we choose to think of ourselves and our relationship to others? And I'm just giving examples to back up the statement. Every moment of every day, we make choices that affirm or deny life in our bodies. This is what's up for us. This is a deeply spiritual battle between good and evil. And the way that we respond to October 7th or to what's happening in Ukraine or what's happening on college campuses or what's happening in the office, in the classroom, many of us, Alex, are feeling it within ourselves. There are inner battles where people are struggling with belief systems that have served them in the past. And now the world is changing. And those belief systems aren't working and they don't know what to do. They're saying, what now? What now? So it's up for all of us right now. And October 7th is a horrible, horrible example of the level of atrocities that push us to the very point where we've got to come to terms with what those belief systems are. And where it doesn't make sense, I'll just say three things. To have the wisdom to know we have a choice, the courage to choose, and the strength to follow through with that choice. If your belief system doesn't serve you, those three things are up for you right now. And there's a lot of good information out there to support everyone going through this in a really, really healthy way.
I think that's such an important thing you said. I want to kind of dig into a little bit more is the belief systems that are not serving you anymore, because, you know, even on every aspect of our life, every aspect from business to our bodies, to our spirituality, to relationships, we have belief systems. And as a podcaster, I started podcasting 8.5 years ago. The things that my belief systems on what worked in a podcast in 2015 do not work in 2023. It's just night and day, where a lot of shows, and I'm using this as an example, a lot of shows or a lot of businesses will stick into the past and won't let go of those belief systems and will be get left behind because they're not adjusting and changing their belief systems and what they're doing. Same thing happens to our bodies. And now even more so our spirituality, where belief systems that were thousands of years old based on dogmatic fear-based religions, people are starting to wake up going, I don't think I want to do that anymore. Yeah. And now there are other choices. And one other thing that you said about our bodies, I'm going to use in media. Whatever you consume will either give you life or tear you down. Yeah. And media and the things, the movies you watch, the books you read, the shows you watch, the podcasts you listen to, will do one of two things. So as so many people that watch the show, they'll go, I don't watch the news anymore. I go to sleep watching your show because it's a good way for my to relax and to get down to that place where I need to rest. Because if you watch the nightly news right before you go to bed, you just can't. I mean, there's no way. There's such a heavy energy that comes through with that. So I wanted to put that message out there, is to really think about these belief systems and what you're consuming, not only in your body, but in your mind and in your spirituality.
What you're saying is so important, you know, and even beyond that, if you are watching, and I know many people who have elderly parents that go to sleep at night on the couch watching the news. Mm-hmm. And the news is a 24-hour news cycle. It's not, it used to be like the 10 o'clock news came on for 30 minutes and then you do the late night talk shows. It's 24-hour news. If you go to sleep and now your brain state has dropped down into the hypnagogic states where we become susceptible to information, these are the brain states that we use for affirmations when we want to change our belief systems. If you go to sleep for 5, 6, 7, 8 hours in front of a 24-hour cable news network that is spouting fear and hate and fear and hate into your subconscious, and you do that night after night after night, what do you think the effect is? I know people who are living examples of that. And interestingly, some of those people have developed early issues with cognition impairment and early stage dementia. Now, dementia is really interesting because on a spiritual level, dementia is when we no longer want to be connected with our world. Okay, when for whatever reason, we no longer want to be connected with our world. I'm hesitating, I'm beating around the bush, and I'll just be very honest. My mom had late stage dementia before she passed. She died from COVID in 21, but she also was in late stage dementia. My mom had a really difficult life. My father was the abusive alcoholic. We've talked about that, with a very dysfunctional family. She had health issues. When my mom left this world, she was a really happy girl because her dementia had led her to a place where she had forgotten everything that ever hurt her. And when I would go to see her here in northern New Mexico, she had a beautiful view out the window of snow-capped mountains and flowers, goats, chickens, rabbits, and she was surrounded by other people in similar conditions. And she loved the beauty. She loved those people. Her body had produced a chemical that intercepted the neural synapse that prevented her from accessing those hurtful experiences. Because before that happened, all she would say was, I just want to forget my past. I want to forget the past. I want to forget the things that hurt me. And our bodies, those are literal commands to a biological system, and our bodies will follow those commands. So when we are watching those scary news programs and we go to sleep, and then all of that fear is being dumped into our subconscious, then we begin to feel that we're not safe in the world and we want to forget all those things. And I don't have any statistical data, but I can tell you anecdotally, I've seen this happen. Maybe some of our viewers have as well, where people having that experience develop the early stage dementia that severs them from the things that frighten them, that severs them from a scary world. And it's a defense mechanism that, we use. So it's just a little aside of how delicate our systems are. We were never meant to see our eyes, Alex. We're never meant to see the things that happened on that field in Israel on October 7th. Mm-hmm. Our hearts were never meant to feel the feelings and to empath with the families and the victims of what they went through. Our minds were never meant to have those images instilled into our synapses, into our memories. We were never meant to have those things. Now, we can adapt to anything. The question is, do we adapt in a healthy way? Or do we adapt by doing the kinds of things that I'm sharing with my mom, by developing defense mechanisms of hate, anger, revenge? Revenge is a powerful, powerful motivator. And then ultimately shutting down the systems that lead us to the things that hurt us. Those are all choices that are up for us right now. So because this battle of good and evil is playing out, and according to some cycles, whether you're looking at indigenous time cycles or spiritual or religious time cycles, we are near some completion point in this battle that opens the door to a new world of peace and love and hope and possibility. And what I know, Alex, is that anybody that's alive right now, if you're in this world right now, you signed up for what's happening right now. And you're a very, very powerful being. You have to be a powerful being to live in the world where the old systems are breaking down, mm-hmm. but the new systems aren't quite ready. And we're in between to live in that world without getting lost in the fear of the unknown. But here's what I know with absolute certainty. We don't want to take the hurt of the old world into that new world. We have the opportunity to heal generational hurt, mm-hmm. from so many, from indigenous, all kinds of indigenous people, Asian indigenous, Aboriginal indigenous, North American indigenous, the hurt that's happening in the Middle East, the hurt in all of the Holocaust throughout Europe over time, from Roman legions, and I mean, it goes on and on and on. This generation, Alex, we're here and we have the power within us to heal that generational hurt. It stops with us, so that as we bridge the old world and the new world, we are the generation that will lead into that new world. We'll be on the front end of that new world. We don't want to take that ancient hurt and the generational hate with us. So things like October 7th are up for us. They are horrible events, but they are triggering a spiritual response. And we get to choose what that response is. And I think that is the real opportunity that is up for all of us right now. Does that make sense if I say it that way?
It does make sense. It does make sense, Gregg. And, you know, thinking about where we're going and what has happened with the war in the Ukraine, which just seemed like to come out of left field, though many of us have seen something potentially happen, but like, oh, it'll never happen. And it happened. And then if you would have said what happened on October 7th was coming, we would have been like, really? Like, that doesn't, seriously? This is a, you know, an argument that's been going on for 2,000 years. And it's still, and I'm like, really? Are we bringing this back up at this level? So then I'm saying, well, what is left? What's the next stage? What's going to happen? My personal belief, I've talked to so many other spiritual leaders as well on the show that believe that it's going to get a little rockier in the short term. In the next year or two, it's going to get a little rockier. We'll be fine, you know, but it's going to get a little rockier. It has to get a little rockier for us to really, like you were saying, we really need to kind of see what we don't want in order to say, I don't want it. And that's where I think we're going to go. But we are honestly at a crossroads. And you've said it so beautifully, that what is your choice? How do you want to come out of these events, these world events that are happening?
Well, the rockiness that you are talking about is the breakdown of unsustainable systems based in power, greed, and centralized authority. Mm-hmm. Those are the systems that we are all tied into now. Those are the systems that are breaking down. And they affect different people at different levels. Some people are more influenced by a collapsing financial system than others. Some people are more influenced by a collapsing agricultural system than others. But ultimately, we are all influenced by one or some combination of those systems. I wrote a book in 2010 called Deep Truth, and I identified going forward into this new world and the scenarios that could lead to it. And one of those scenarios is that, you know, we could have avoided so much suffering and so much hurt. Mm-hmm. Alex, if the leaders of the world, the big powers, China, Russia, the United States, Iran, if those leaders had come together, and other nations, I'm just using those for examples, had come together in the late 20th century and said, look, the world is changing. We have the potential to work together as nations. We each have something that the other one needs, and we all want the best for our people, and we want the best for this world. What great and beautiful things can we do together to lead this world into something new and different? That could have happened. That could, and there probably is a parallel reality where that did happen somewhere. Think how different the world would be if those nations would work together on behalf of their people. But that didn't happen. So that is one scenario. There's another scenario where a crisis, a calamity, some big event happens that brings everything crashing down and we have to start all new again, whether it's an asteroid hitting the Earth or a solar flare, a nuclear war, whatever it is, something brings everything to a sudden halt and we have to start over. And the third scenario that I think is probably what we're seeing right now, kind of melding with what I just said, is that the systems buckle and collapse one by one, and we address them one by one until they buckle and collapse so quickly and in such rapid succession, so close together, that we've got to take a look at what's happening. And I think that is the rocky times that you're saying that other spiritual leaders are seeing. We're witnessing the collapse of a banking system, of centralized finance, centralized agriculture, centralized energy, fossil fuel-based energy, and political goals and political ideologies that are no longer sustainable. All of those are happening, and more, but they're all happening at the same time. And here we are, we're living our lives, you know, we're trying to take care of our kids, put food on the table, maybe see a movie on the weekends, have some semblance of an intimate life or a love life with another human on this planet, and be healthy and do our yoga and take good care of ourselves in the midst of all that. And that's why I say we're such powerful beings. And it's difficult sometimes to really embrace how powerful we are. But it doesn't take many people to hold a vision of what is possible. Alex, I just have to share, this is so interesting. I have been, it was since September. I've been on the road, mostly in Europe, some in the United States and South America. So I've been with audiences all over the world. And I ask those audiences two questions. I say, number one, how many want a different world? And everybody raises their hands. And then I say, okay, what does that world look like? This is the problem. We don't have a solid collective vision of what's possible. Now, I'm going to share something. This is really powerful, and it's really subtle. When people think of the new world, Alex, the way they do it is by thinking of the existing world and how to make it better, rather than letting the existing world go and saying, what do we need? What would serve us? What would work? Because all we know is what we know. So people are thinking about what we have today and how to improve upon it, rather than letting those systems go and saying, here is what would really honor and serve our community when it comes to finances and banking and even government. Mm-hmm. The whole idea of government takes on new meaning when we think about this new world. I have a number of podcasts that I do with an organization called the Arlington Institute, just outside of DC. And we've had these conversations with other thought leaders. So what we're moving toward, Alex, is we are building for ourselves a collective sense of what that better world can look like. And it's based upon our perceptions that we are not worthy and that we are powerless victims of a world that we have no control over. So as we open our spiritual development and we accept more love for ourselves and we empower the intelligence of the human body, our immune response, our longevity enzymes, our resilience response, as we do that for ourselves, that is reflected in what we embrace as possible for a new world. We begin to build a vision of a new world based on a deeper love for ourselves and a greater acceptance for who we are and what's possible. And I think that is what we're ultimately, I think that's where we're all going right now.
Greg, so many people ask me about the great awakening, the shift in consciousness, this new world that you're talking about. But they say, well, if we're supposedly growing in consciousness and we're becoming more evolved as spiritual beings and we're waking up, why is all of this happening to us right now? And I think we've answered a little bit of it during this conversation, but if you can answer that directly, because that is a question I get asked a lot by my community, is like, if we're so awakening and we're so evolving and we're so, you know, becoming higher spiritual beings and awakening, why are we still dealing with this kind of old hat of
I think the answer is in the question.
Yeah.
The answer is in the question, because as we awaken within ourselves, we're awakening within the context of a world that was created when we were asleep. Mm-hmm. So we are awakening from the constraints of the world that we consented to in our sleep. On some level, we've all consented to the power and the control that we're experiencing. You gave a perfect example in World War II, how, you know, Hitler didn't happen overnight. There was a series of events. There was a process that unfolded where people were promised an easier life, where they were promised that someone else would take care of them so they wouldn't have to take care of themselves. And they went for it. They gave away their methods of self-defense. They were disarmed. And they said, you don't need to be armed. We'll take care of you. They gave away their means of production. They said, you don't need factories, you know, private ownership. Government will take care of you. And people say, oh, great, great. This sounds like a great plan. They were giving away their power every step of the way until they'd given away so much of their power when it was obvious that it was not a good path. They had no power left. And I think that microcosm is an example of what has happened collectively, civilizationally. And so we have given our power away in so many ways. And I'm not just talking about the East or the West, or it just collectively it's happened in our past. Now we're awakening within the context of a world where we've given that power away and it doesn't make sense. And so now this is the generation. There has to be one generation that bridges these two ways of being, that bridges this awakening. It's not like we all go to sleep one night on a Friday night at midnight and we wake up Monday morning and the new world is here. That would be nice collectively. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Kind of like daylight savings.
Whether we like it or not, it's always there.
Yeah, and our internal clocks are reset, but that's not what's happening. So we all have to go through individually and whatever it means for us as we awaken. There has to be one generation that has lived and mastered an old way of being. And, you know, we think we've got it figured out and, you know, all buttoned up nice and tidy. And then that system begins to buckle and collapse because it's unsustainable. A new system is emerging, but it's not here yet. There's got to be a generation that bridges those two ways of being, even just a little window, a short period of time, a little window. Doesn't go on forever, but it takes a really strong being to live in the uncertainty of that in between. And we're seeing unprecedented levels of people leaving this world, either by choice, a lot of them are taking their own lives, or through other, you could argue, karmic processes, mm-hmm. you know, whatever that means, because they feel overwhelmed. They feel like they can't navigate this little window of time. If we're here now, this is why we're here. Community is vital for us to be able to come together and share ideas and share solutions. There are no answers, but there are many possible solutions for us individually. There's not one single answer. There are many solutions. And we share them in community and say, oh yeah, well that works for me and this works for me. So as the economic system breaks down, you've got to have a parallel system to fall back on. As financial systems break down, you've got to have a parallel system to fall back on. As centralized food distribution breaks down, you've got to have some kind of a backup for you and your family. As energy systems break down, you've got to have some kind of a backup for your home. We're living a time of extremes. It makes sense, not out of fear, but out of the recognition that this is a rare and precious window of time. We get to choose a new world as the old world buckles and collapses under the weight of its own unsustainability. And as we do that together, as our collective family, this is how we empower one another. It all has to begin in here. It all has to begin with us feeling worthy of this beautiful new world of peace and prosperity, of us feeling and embracing the deep truth of the temple of our bodies. This is Next Level Soul Podcast. So I can call our bodies literally the temple of the soul. Mm-hmm. And to honor our bodies, if any time we needed to be healthy, now is the time. We need to be healthier than ever so that we can move through this precious window of time in the best way possible. And there, you know, a million ways to go about doing that. So I think this is where we are. October 7th did not happen in a vacuum. It is happening within the context of converging cycles, the battle between good and evil, us coming close to the end of a timeline or a timeline split where we are building a new world. We're becoming the new humans, and our response to the atrocities of October 7th, in many respects, it defines which of those timelines we choose, which of those timelines Earth begins to follow. And I think this is a very, very powerful perspective for those who are on the spiritual path right now. What do we become in the presence of what the universe, what life has just brought to our doorstep? That's the question.
Gregg, if there's somebody watching right now who has been in that kind of echo chamber of their own understanding, their own perspective, their own programming, and they only see the one side and they have not yet ventured out into this other perspective up from the other side, what would you say to someone listening who has that problem right now? Not problem, but are dealing with that right now.
Yeah, well, it's happening. It's happening to my friends. It's happening to my family. It's happening to my colleagues. I have colleagues who have been so entrenched in a belief system for 40 years, and that belief system has failed them. And they feel betrayed by that belief system and shocked and hopeless and powerless until they look deep within themselves and see that they've always had everything they need. And this is where these, you know, we call them esoteric teachings, but the reality is, Alex, they're the foundation of everyday life.
Mm-hmm.
That invite us to find a way to love ourselves, and all the ways that that means through, you know, through health, through finance, through, you know, all the things that we're talking about here, it all invites us to begin to love ourselves in new and deeply powerful ways, and allow the love for ourselves to be mirrored and reflected in the choices that we make in policy, in law, politics. And, you know, you and I live in a nation where this is going to be up for us. We're in an election year, 2024. You're going to see all kinds of narratives driven by AI and fifth generational warfare to drive us to make choices that serve other people. Mm-hmm. And whether it's climate, whether it's politics, whether it's finance, whether it's economics, central bank, digital currency, you know, health issues, whatever, it's, we're going to see it all in the next 12 months. And this is where community is going to be vital. So we can check in with one another and find out what one another knows and be open to possibilities. What I would say to someone is bless the belief systems that have served you in the past so well that you're standing here today. You can only be here if your belief mm-hmm. system served you in the past. Bless them and let them go, because those belief systems were formed within the context of a world that no longer exists. And open your heart to the deep truth of the love that is available for you, your family, and your world, and the new belief systems that will support that love. Any belief system that asks us to hate or to judge another person, or to tell us that we need something outside of our bodies to be healthy and to compete successfully in the world, I would be suspect of those kinds of conversations. But we need to be discerning. And the last thing I would say is there's a very powerful, deeply spiritual difference between judgment and discernment. Judgment is where we judge another as good, bad, you know, whatever we want to call it. Discerning is where we can recognize the qualities in other people that are not healthy and are not good for us without judging the people that bear those qualities. Very, very deep, very powerful spiritual principle. So as we move into the new world, discernment is going to be really, really key in helping us to make healthy choices. And then I would tell that person, I would thank them for all they've done to be the best version of themselves and all that they are doing to create the best world possible. That's what I would say to them.
My friend, where can people find out more about you and the amazing work that you're doing in the world?
I am, I'm on the command deck of the mothership right now.
Obviously, sir. Obviously.
No, I'm coming from our studio outside of Santa Fe, New Mexico. All of the information for all of the tours, all of the retreats, all the books, everything, it's on our website, Gregg Braden, G-R-E-G-G, 2 G's, .com. That's probably the best place. We'll direct to our YouTube channel where we've got tons of information on the things that we've talked about here. I want to thank everybody for your love and support as we go through this together. Community is key. Family is key. And Alex, I want to thank you for your trust in bringing me, because the truth is you never really know where this is going to go. And I don't either. It's unscripted. And that mm-hmm. takes a level of trust to bring me into your family. And it means a lot to me, and I appreciate it. So thank you, my brother, for all you do to keep us connected. You're an amazing hub of community, all focused on Alex Ferrari and Next Level Soul Podcast. And yes. It's needed, and I appreciate it very much. So thank you.
And I appreciate this conversation so much. It is a conversation that I've been wanting to have, and I was looking for the right guest to have this kind of deep conversation and address a lot of the issues that my audience has been dealing with and asking questions about. So I appreciate you for coming on, for being so candid, to being so supportive and so loving in the responses to my questions. And I appreciate and hope that this episode is going to do some good in the world and help us get to that new world that you were so lovely, so beautifully talking about, my friend. So thank you, and thank you for everything that you do as well, my friend.
Thank you so much. I look forward so much to our next. Thank you, Alex.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.